Welcome to all of you. Good morning from those who listen us from Brazil. Good afternoon for those who are connecting themselves from Europe and Italy. And good evening for those who are connected with us from Asia. Warm welcome to all of the friends that are connected with us and that are going to take part in this event. I am Professor Sarli, and I teach at the Department of Medicine and Surgery of the University of Parma, and I represent the University Center for International Cooperation, to which we refer through the acronym CUCI, so the CUCI Association of my university. I never happen to greet people who live so far away from me and coming from all over the world. But this is perfectly relating to the subject matter and the topic we're going to discuss this afternoon. And so health as a common good, so the sharing of international experiences during the COVID-19 pandemic. The pandemic has been a disaster for the whole world. We are all suffering together. But at the same time, it has been an event that has been teaching us a lot of things. And among the so many things it has been teaching us, it has enabled us to realize not only that we cannot wholly control our planet, despite we were absolutely convinced of that for so many years, but we even realized in a circumstance like this that we definitely need to join and to stay together, all united, and to cooperate with all the human beings living in the globe, in the planet, notwithstanding the fact that in some areas of our planet, drug conflicts, wars, borders, notwithstanding the color of our skin and our religious faiths, the pandemic taught us that health is not an asset or a good for individual beings, and it is not simply relating to ourselves and our loved ones, together with the society with in which we live, but it is an asset and a good that concerns the whole world. Yesterday, I was listening to Professor Fauci in a webinar, and Professor Fauci stated that even if we are vaccinated in Europe or in the US, but we do not involve the countries such as Africa or Asian countries in which there are problems to reach the vaccine, we will never solve the problem because the virus will keep muting. There will be variants, and variants will be resisting our vaccines. And so the virus will inexorably resist among us. And so this pointed out that health is a common good, an unalienable right of every human being, and therefore it has to be protected and defended. So this is the reason why we wanted to organize this meeting and this webinar. And during this webinar, we are going to listen to the experiences in this time of pandemic from different parts of our world. We are also giving voice to those of us who are more in difficulty with respect to the rollout of vaccines. And probably the pandemic is going to teach us something today too, or at least this is our deep hope. So I now would like to give the floor to the rector of the University of Parma, and it is an honor for us to have him among us. I'm listening to this webinar with my wife, and she is also pretty much interested in what we are going to state. And so a warm greeting on her behalf too. So Paola, I give you the floor. So thank you and a warm welcome, wholeheartedly welcome to all of you who accepted to participate in this meeting, which is so important for the topics we are going to talk about, mostly because the main subject matter of the seminar is fundamental in this very moment. Professor Sarli was pointing out that the health is a common good, and that we all have the duty to protect and to guarantee a universal access to health care. And when I say universal, I mean that there must be no differences, contrarily to what we've been realizing during the last 2 years. We've been realizing this with great intensity. So we must make endeavors so that there is one health approach and not such differing and diverse healthcare systems, because this brings about as a consequence that the access to healthcare is not equal to everybody. So the food for thought that we are going to obtain from this webinar goes well beyond the topic of COVID, but anyway, it can help us to reflect about how can we obtain and achieve a greater equalness of healthcare systems, because very often the differences are generated by economic troubles that may often lead to make inadequate and uneven choices. And we also want this webinar to be an occasion to share views and to share approaches with a common end, protecting the right to healthcare for everybody. This must be our beam for the future. And I say this representing my university, a university that has in education and research its main assets. And education and research aim at being useful for the well-being of all human being. So I think that it is therefore extremely important that this webinar has been organized within the activities of our center, University Center for International Cooperation, because the mission of this cooperation center is exactly this, the fact of going beyond the barriers of ideologies, going beyond the barriers that may be generated by diversities that are seen not as a wealth, but as a barrier in the finding of the best solutions to our daily problems must be helpful for us to learn the most important lesson. Nobody must be left behind. None of us really knows the truth, but the most important lesson I'm learning from this tragedy that struck the whole planet is that, on the one hand, we cannot save ourselves alone, and this has been stated not by me, but by Pope Francis, and on the other hand, that we all have to commit ourselves for our brothers, for the others. So the well-being of the planet, the well-being of all the human being also depend on me, also depend on you. So if we want a better future for all of us, we must commit in person. So for us, the lesson that we will learn from this webinar will be even the more so important, because it will enable us to reflect on hints coming from all over the world. I would like to thank Professor Sally and all the organizers of this webinar. And I hope I would like to organize a meeting like this in person and not simply through a webinar platform, because I think that another lesson that we learned from this tragedy is that nothing, and I state it again, nothing can replace our need of connections and relationships with people. So when we have to talk of so important topics, it is extremely important to have the chance to share our views in person. So my hope is to have in the future the possibility of having you all in person here in Parma to talk again about this topic. So thank you for being with us. Thank you to all of you. Thank you, Professor Andrei, the Rector of the University of Parma. I thank you for your words and I thank you for being with us, because it has been an honor for us. And I also would like to thank you, because you definitely helped us in realizing and organizing this event, because it fully supported us so that we can organize this webinar. Now I would like to give the floor to the moderator, Clelia Dapice. Maybe you have already been listening to her at the very beginning of the webinar when she was sharing with you the technical infos. Miss Clelia Dapice, she is also a PhD student at the University of Medicine of Parma, and she is also an active member of the CUCI Cooperation Center of the University of Parma. So Clelia, I give the floor so that you can introduce our guests.
Thank you. Thank you very much to Prof. Sarli. Thank you very much to our rector, and especially thank you very much to all of you for being with us today. It is really a great honor and a privilege to me to be moderating this important conference and to be hosting such experienced and distinguished guest speakers. As Professor Sarli and Rector Andrei said, the COVID-19 pandemic really showed us that the solution to this issue cannot be reached independently by individual states, but it must necessarily involve the collaboration of the entire planet. Nowadays, however, as we all are unfortunately aware of, not everything is working in this direction as it should be. The aim of this conference is then that of casting light on what is happening in the world to probe to which extent health is a common good. This sharing of experience is an asset to me, both as a professional, as I am doing a PhD in public health, and as I am collaborating with the Center for International Cooperation of our university, including collaboration with several of the countries that are represented today by our distinguished speakers. And also, it is an asset as a human being, as I'm really struggling to recognize the right to health as the most important global good to protect. In particular, there is a famous quote from Dr. Gino Strada, founder of the NGO Emergency, that always come to my mind and I would like to share before starting. If one of us, any one of us human being, is now suffering like a dog, is sick or hungry, it is something that affects all of us. It must concern us all, because ignoring a man's suffering is always an act of violence and one of the most outrageous. So sharing experiences and learning one from the other to better answer to the pandemic and to all the future challenges that we will face is really of utmost importance. So thank you all again for being with us today. And I have now the honor and the privilege to give the floor to Dr. Zoe So. Dr. Zoe So is Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education of the Myanmar National Unity Government, the NUG, the new democratic government nominated by the CRPH, which is the committee representing the democratically elected parliamentarians following the last November elections. And it is the government answering in contrast to the military coup of 1st February 2021. Minister Zoe So will illustrate us the COVID-19 situation and the management of the pandemic in Myanmar. And it will also share information on the COVID vaccine situation before the coup and following the military takeover. During the COVID-19 emergency before the coup, he has served as Vice President of the Yangon Region COVID-19 Prevention, Control and Management Coordination Committee. And now is Acting Minister of Health and is coordinating the answer to the pandemic. So Minister Zoe So, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Galilea. And first of all, I would like to say thanks to all organizing committee inviting me to this webinar. And I also like to, this is a, you know, honor and privilege for me to be with all of you from international and especially particularly to the rectors, Andrew, and then Professor Sally for, you know, allowing me and then inviting me to talk about the COVID-19 in Myanmar. This is my first slide. As Kalilia mentioned that I was rector of the University of Medicine and also chairman of the Rector's Committee for the National Education Policy Commission and a member of the COVID-19 control and vice chair of the COVID-19 control and management in Yangon region. And actually, I think you know that now I'm in the liberated area. Before I leave to the liberated area, because you know, military, they tried to arrest me, and then they tried to find me, and then also according to the penal code, and then you know, maximum tried to kill me, and then also death sentence. That's why these slides, actually, I don't have computer. That's why, you know, these slides are from my email, and then I have to download again, and then, you know, I have to talk to you. Thanks. Next slide, please. I think, as you all know, Myanmar, you know, this is the, you know, our COVID-19 situation in Myanmar. And we first two cases of the you know, COVID-19 found on 23rd of March 2020. And then within 3 months, there's a no local transmission. These two cases, imported cases, and all are imported cases. But, and 16 August 2020, there's first case in Rakhine. Actually, that case is from the, come from the western part of the Myanmar. You know, in India, they have, what at the time, India having a COVID-19, you know, outbreak, and India to Bangladesh, and Bangladesh to the Rakhine. And then Rakhine, 16th of August, we found the first case in Rakhine, and 24th August, we found the first case in Yangon. And this is until the my last data that I have, because I have to, you know, after have coup, and we cannot get the data properly. Next slide, please. In Myanmar, actually, we have 54 million people. This is I'm talking about university because I'm a rector of the university, and the medical university are a key player in the COVID-19 control. Next slide, please. And Myanmar, we form a COVID-19 clinical management committee and a COVID-19 designated hospital and COVID-19 medical center and COVID-19 related training that what we did in the university and facility quarantine center and contact tracing and volunteering university student and medical university teacher and all these, you know, clinical personnel are involved in these activities. Next slide, please. And this is first wave, as I mentioned, all are imported cases. Next slide, please. This is the, country have a peculiarity. Myanmar peculiarity are 2 million migrant workers are working abroad out of 54 million, 70% working in Thailand and Malaysia, China, Korea, Singapore, and then also in the US, UK, UAE, Japan, Qatar, and Macau. That's why, you know, most of all the first wave, patient, yeah, came back from the other country. We are lucky, long summer holiday, and then family gathering, because Myanmar about 90% Buddhism, and we are preparing for the summer holiday meditation center. That's why we have a meditation center already for the quarantine. We use the meditation center as a quarantine, and then also we use the school and university as a quarantine center. Next slide, please. First, we did massive facility quarantine. We kept them, in the facility quarantine and home quarantine and lockdown. We use university and school as the facility quarantine area and meditation center we use as a quarantine center, and donated hotels and donated foods and material. Quarantine period was 2 weeks in the quarantine center. Next slide, please. They have to stay in the quarantine center for 2 weeks. Or no one can go home directly. We did keep them in the quarantine center for 2 weeks. COVID-19 Clinical Management Committee, this is what we have done in the during this time, at that time, Clinical Management Committee, we did COVID-19 Clinical Management Guideline and Community Fever Clinic Guideline, ICU Guideline, and Surgical Safety Guideline that we produce in Myanmar. Next, please. And then we set up the designated hospital, COVID-19 designated hospital, 2 infectious disease hospital. There are 100 beds. Before COVID-19, they had only one, but we set up another one hospital, and that's why we can have 300 beds for the COVID-19. Next, please. And medical center. This is the dedicated medical center. We transformed from a clinic, a central institute of civil service, to the 2,000 bedded COVID-19 designated dedicated hospital. Next slide, please. We equip, because actually this is the, you know, a training center. We transformed training center to the hospital. Next slide, please. And also we set up the ICU and then also oxygen therapy. Next. And these are the phases that we developed: 20 ICU bed, 240 HDU and 240 regular bed, and the liquid oxygen laboratory. And then these are the things that we set up and put in the medical center, COVID-19 medical center, you know, medical store. And then also a Wi-Fi for the patient. And then also we set up the incinerator. Next, please. In Myanmar at that time, we under the, you know, people elective NLD government, and then leading by the state councilor Aung San Suu Kyi. That's why we are united, government, ministry, and Myanmar Defense Service, Medical Corps, and then private hospital, construction company, pharmaceutical company, NGO, donor, all the citizens, we are united, and then we organize the COVID-19 to fight the COVID-19. Next. That's why we control for the first wave, and we have only 375 cases and only 6 dead. But in second wave, COVID-19 second wave, next, as I mentioned, already mentioned to you, from the 16th of April, we started to have a second wave. And I was a vice chairman of the COVID-19 control. And we use containment strategy. We try to contain as much as we can. And then also we're not allowed to allowed to stay at home or allowed to live at home. If there's a positive case, we keep in the COVID-19 dedicated center. Next slide, please. And these are the cases, I mean, photographs showing the second wave pattern. And then the green arrow are COVID-19 center. We opened COVID-19 center altogether. There's a 15 COVID-19 center to accommodate the 20,000 positive cases. Next, please. And these are the center that we open, and then you know, our treatment center all together within 35 days we open all these you know center, and then also we included the ICU and HTU. Dedicated ICU and HTU for COVID-19. Next, please. Actually, this is the data from the COVID-19 center. Next. And COVID-19 center, next, please. This is what we have, you know, pulse oximeter. And then State Councilor Dr. Aung San Suu Kyi, she lead our COVID-19 control. With the mask campaign, and then next yellow campaign for, you know, masks, hand washing, and then distancing, and that we did with the COVID-19 yellow campaign and COVID-19 control. Next. Because of the effort from the government, and because of the effort from the Ministry of Health and Sports, and because of the effort from the people, we control the second wave. Before the coup, we have only about 17 or 16 cases a day, positive cases a day, that come down from the 2,000 cases, positive cases a day. From the, you know, only 16 or 15 cases a day. Next. That's why at that time I was, you know, dreaming no third wave, no new normal, new living, new Yango, and vaccine for all. Because of the State Councilor Dr. Aung San Suu Kyi, she put a lot of input when we are having controlling the COVID-19 at that time, and government tried to give vaccination to give all the people in Myanmar, and then that's why we have a rollout plan for the whole country. You know, in Myanmar, we started the vaccination in second week of January 2021. I think Myanmar is one of the country, very first country in Asia to have that kinds of, you know, vaccination for COVID-19 because of the effort of the previous government. But we are very unlucky. And then I'm very sad and about that, because first of February 2021, we have darkness, coup, and then we lost all these, you know, dream. Next slide, please. Next slide. Actually, this is the pandemic situation I already mentioned. I think these are all that I have mentioned. And then first February, we have coup. And then this is the situation, current situation. And then a different region with the different, data on daily May, MOHS data. Next, please. And this is the graph that's showing COVID-19 control. But now we don't know where we are because we don't have data. And we cannot have a proper, a vaccination program because of the military coup and people are protesting. And then also healthcare workers are protesting with the CDM. And that's why, we cannot have a proper data. And then also we cannot have a proper vaccination program. And also people are saying that they want elected, government. And then they want Aung San Suu Kyi, state counselor, to free. Otherwise, they are not going to get injection and they are not going to get vaccination. That is a issue in Myanmar. Next slide, please. And this is our rollout plan. We have a proper rollout plan and then also the whole country and then we plan. And also there's a lot of donor from the Myanmar people. They donated the money for the vaccination. And then government we have in hand, everything is ready. But because of the coup, next slide please. Now military also trying, but military is doing the public announcement to receive the vaccine to all the people above the age of 18 years old to utilize the vaccine as their credit to the public, which is totally deviated from the original deploy plan. Without having that kind of deploy plan, I think maybe you all know you are the expert in the immunization and vaccination. We cannot get proper immunity in Myanmar. That's why I'm very, very bad. I feel bad and sad. And then also, I would like to request all of you to support us and to help us to the National Unity Government of Myanmar and then Ministry of Health. Thank you so much. Thank you. We this is the our plan. Because I have manpower, because all the CDM are with me, and then healthcare staff are with me, and also we have logistic, and then we are trying to talk, engage with the WHO and UN, and then also a development partner. But until now, I haven't had a proper support and program from the from the people that I have engaged. Thank you so much. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Minister. That was extremely interesting, and I think it was quite shocking for all the people that were listening. I would like only to stress the difference in what you have been doing to manage and control the pandemic before the coup and the great results that you have in containing the pandemic. Also, thanks to the efforts and the collaboration of the community that was really much involved in preventing the explosion of the pandemic. And the situation nowadays, because as you said, since the military takeover, the COVID pandemic is, we cannot say if it is out of control, of course, but there are no testing, there is no quarantine. And so cases could be rising every day. And as you said, the military are trying to bribe people and health professionals in particular to be standing on their side if they get the vaccine. So thank you very much. I do thank you on behalf of all the people listening for your sharing with us. And I invite you to stay with us for at least the next half an hour, because I'm sure there will be comments and questions for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I now welcome very much Professor Asim Doferla. Professor Ferla is a professor at the Federal University of Rio Grande do Sul in Brazil. Thank you very much, Professor, for being with us. Prof. Ferla will provide us an overview of the Brazilian health system, especially in relation to the capillarity of the basic healthcare in the unified health system, which is generally known as SUS. He will present the initiatives concerning the organization of work in this area of care, seeking analytical approach between basic care, which was originally used in the reform process in the 80s, and the concept of proximity or territorial care, which is mainly used in Italy. The objective of this analytical approximation is to highlight the potential of territorial work in dealing with the pandemic. Prof. Ferla will also cast light on the tragic situation ongoing in Brazil, highlighting on the one hand the disservice of the current government in managing the pandemic, and on the other hand, the resistance of the territories in responding to the outbreak. Prof. Ferla, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Clelia. Thank you to the University of Parma and Professor Sali for inviting me. This is an important update of the situation. Okay, so. I will speak in Portuguese to present my speech, but I have prepared some slides in Italian. I perfectly understand Italian, but I cannot speak Italian, so I will speak in Portuguese. And I will talk about the basic health care, which is a Brazilian expression, which is the basis of our health system. This is a basic, which is the basic concept. This pandemic proved that our health systems and services have to leave their traditional places and move within the territories. Inequalities and injustice are widespread over the territory. And the complexity of life stresses the difficulties in COVID and dealing with this COVID pandemic. We need to work a lot to give the right answer and to respond over the whole country to this pandemic and taking care of the whole territories. There are extremely different responses among the countries, and this proves the lack of solidarities within the countries and the population living in different countries. Every time 1,000 or 450,000 lives are taken due to negligence, due to diseases, due to war or genocides, life must be a civilizing asset to be developed, the life of each of us. Here you see our president. This is the Brazilian president riding his bike last Sunday. We registered 400,000 deaths, more than 400,000 deaths, and this is what the current situation of deaths in Brazil. We are a big continent. We are a continental dimension. There are a lot of diversities, inequalities, crises. There are 27 states and 5,568 communities, municipalities, let's say, with a territorial autonomy. There are also some high inequalities in regions and municipalities. A story of public policies of inclusion and democracy, which is quite recent and is living now a crisis, an institutional crisis, which has been recognized at the international level. So what we need to overcome the crisis is a global support. The healthcare system is called in Brazil Sistema Único de Saúde, SUS, was created in 1988 through our federal constitution. It has to allow universal access, integrality of cares, decentralization of administration and policies, and the social participation in the creation and of policies and in the management control over the whole Brazilian territory. In the pandemic, the conditioning factors for the health proved the great complexity of health in the territory where a lot of people live. And often both the equipment, medicines and procedures are not sufficient to preserve, to recover and produce health over these territories. Complexity and technological density are not synonyms, and so they require great capacities. The pandemic proved and evidenced a crisis of civilization, showing the impossibility to follow life in a normal way, the way we did before this world event. Injuries to the democracy and to life are widespread all over our world and are affected by economic and political interests. What can we do now? The destruction of the planet, of democracies, of health systems, of mankind, and the modernization of life, will all these elements continue? Will we go on to continue and finance wars and the extinction of peoples silently? We built proximity care systems. We developed health workers to listen and help the life over the territories. We have organized health systems living in the streets, but we need to do more. A Brazilian leader must live in the streets, and one of them told me, we have to keep hand by hand with everyone and not to leave nobody behind. The space isolation created by the pandemic must not isolate our human condition. What we also need is kindness and poetry. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Prof. Perla. Thank you very much for your for what you share with us and for underlining some topics that I believe would be rediscussed also by other guest speakers, and in particular the role of the determinants of health, also in determining inequities and inequalities of access in health, and also the role of communities and of bottom-up approaches, how territories can support and answer where governments are not responding. Thank you very much. I have now the pleasure of introducing Dr. Andrea Astori, which is head of international relations at the Italian NGO Doctors with Africa QAM. Dr. Astori will present the answer of QAM to the COVID-19 pandemic in some countries in Africa. In particular, he will share with us examples from Angola, Ethiopia, Mozambique, and some other countries. He will describe the approach of the QAM to the pandemic, focusing on challenges, interventions, and future scenarios. Dr. Astori, you have the floor.
Okay, if you can see the slides.
Yes, perfect.
Doctors with Africa QAM is an international NGO, as Clelia already told. We work only in Africa. We have more than 70 years of history, and we have a long-term development approach. So that means that we work with Ministry of Health, local partners, facilities, university, and teaching schools to create better system for people and patients. What we do is to improve quality and access to basic services, especially for women and children. We look for the most vulnerable, and everything we do is happening in the last mile. I do the next slide myself. Last mile means is there where all the people are coming for example, in the well-served urban areas, but in the rural, remote areas where there is a lack of transportation, there is a lack of services, where usually opportunity are fewer than in other places. In these places where we try to build a better health system. Now, of course, we have to face, despite the number in Africa seems to be lower than Europe and other regions, the COVID-19 pandemic have a devastating effect. Of course, we have to try to respond to the COVID-19 despite keeping the normal programs going on. And we did it in a free way. First of all, we had specific African programs. We had to launch a new global supply program. And then we, after long thinking, we also start an Italian response to COVID as a QAM. In Africa, we focus on the health and the safety of healthcare workers and health staff. We've done some facility improvement, community education, and then I will discuss later. We also have special programs now to address the collateral effects of COVID-19. As we speak in Africa, I want to show you some images as well. Securing a facility or improving a facility meant exactly what we did in Ebola a few years ago. So it was to set up triage, set up entry exit pathway for patient, screening point, everything that a usual rural hospital in Africa doesn't have, because it's something, again, we used and pilot during the Ebola epidemic in Sierra Leone, but now we had to import in over 25 hospitals, for example, hundreds of health centers in 8 countries where we work. The second point is to motivate and protect the human resources. So we've done a lot of training of personnel on PPE usage, because in many countries, you know, things are not available, they were not trained to use it, there was lots of fear to get infected. So as we try to stabilize the supply line, we will see later the supply line, it also meant to reassure people about the using of PPE, how to use them, and the fact they can provide services to people in a safer way. And the third leg was mobilizing the community. The community had a huge impact at the beginning for two reasons. The first was there was a stigma around COVID, and people were not accessing hospital anymore. So we had a drop, and we'll see again later when we discuss about the collateral effects, a drop in people accessing hospital, even pregnant women or people with HIV that need to pick up drugs because they thought the hospital could become a foci, could become a place where they were getting infected. So we had to do a lot of community mobilization. And doing community mobilization, you will see picture later, we also set up a number of WASH, for example, point in the community. I almost would say that this was an opportunity to improve WASH at community level and making a more throughout education about anything that is from a viral disease like this one to, for example, a diarrhea cause for other causes. So let's run on a few pictures. These are the operation in Ethiopia, for example. As you see, health center, hospital setting up triage, providing thermometers, educating people, etc. This is Angola. This is the triage stand before the Shula Hospital. This is on the other side. You see Hospital Rural de Mukuba, Mozambique. Few more pictures. For example, this is what is meant social distancing in meeting for healthcare staff. That means outside is Uganda, I guess. They're very, you know, Ugandan are very educated and straight people, so they apply immediately, you know, the outside distancing. This is a picture of distributing PPE. Distributing PPE in Africa means sometimes means 2 days, you know, 4x4 wheel drive transportation. And on the other side, you will see some new facilities for washing and etc. I want to stress the fact that everything we've done in WASH was in integrating in a wider program. So again, it was a big challenge, but also an opportunity to bring WASH activities. WASH is water and sanitation and hygiene, is an acronym, to attention. So we use it a lot in community, for example, to prevent diarrheal diseases. More pitching on community level, signs everywhere. Of course, you see these in our countries. But again, washing hands before entering public office, checking temperature, etc. So this was the pure African intervention we did. And I think we were able to at least maintain the routine work of a number of health facilities, despite, you know, the fear that was around COVID, the fact that we had to create special places where to treat positive cases, isolate them, etc. Now, to sustain response, there was, for the first time, probably even in Guam time, a major logistic operation. This major logistic operation, we said at the beginning of this meeting, it was not possible if we work alone. So we seek a partnership with UNHCR, that is the UN logistic hubs, and we stock PPE material in Dubai, Brindisi, Guangzhou, China, and we've done a number of humanitarian flights with the European Union from Lyon to supply people. So this is an image that tried to summarize everything in a nice slide, in which we tried for the first time to have an international procurement, creation of stock, then again, in partnership, we thank UNHRD because they donate all the flight. We ship over the protection items. That's a map of the first 4 months of operation. You see the number of flights we've been shipping PPE. And the PPE were then becoming what you see in the picture before. So they're becoming a treasure for the local hospital in retaining staff and protecting them from the pandemic. Now, why do we do this? We were also, of course, we are based in Italy, so I should have said that before, but in Italy, there was the first kind of major epidemic in terms of national scale. We were in red zone, and however, a number of people that work with Guam, we have more than 3,000 medical doctors and nurses that work with Guam in Italy, they're now embedded in the public system, they were asking for help. So we start a program in Italy, again, probably this kind of program was the first time in Guam history in which we've been trying to do what you see now. We done the first intervention in providing equipment, training, and PPE to Italian professional to expand the capacity of a critical care unit. And then we apply for a US fund for Italy at the moment was, and we developed the Italian response to COVID project. The Italian response to project COVID, I don't want to spend too much time here, is now operational in 11 region. it does help more than 20 hospitals in Italy to set up triage and you know, and improve the pathway, exit open, checkings, etc. We built a number of new way in which we expand the capacity hospital in terms of clean and dirty, for example, changing of clothes of nurses and staff and things like that. Then we open up a couple of points for vulnerable population and marginalized, in which we done anything from screening from COVID to food assistance, because that was the situation at the moment. And then we're very proud to launch a major training campaign in Italy for health staff, on two training packages. One is called Just in Time, and we put together all our experience on Ebola and other major epidemics in Africa to the Italian context. So we are training people about triage, macro emergencies, differences between, you know, Fauci epidemic, pandemic, PPE, etc. And the second one is a kind of innovative package for health professional to deal with the stress caused by this long-term crisis. And this is called Fit for Care. So we teach professional how to stay fit, how to deal with stress, how to breathe, for example, with all the PPE dressed. So this is the Italian program. Now we have two major challenges ahead as a QAM. We have the new challenge of the vaccination in Africa. We launched the campaign Vaccino per Noi, a vaccine for us, in which we're going to help 8 countries in Africa not to purchase vaccination that will come from the COVAX, but to distribute them to make sure that each vaccine become a vaccination. So we are going to help them logistically in technical assistance and in delivery if necessary, for make sure that we're going to be able to vaccinate the whole continent. I agree with, you know, with the rector when he said, and quoting Dr. Fauci, that if we are not vaccinating everybody, we are not vaccinating anybody, because India is learning, you know, how much can damage can do a small variant in the virus. And so we don't want to see the COVID coming back in another form. So it's a moral duty, I guess, but it's also very clever to do so. And we are seeking the help of everybody. Now, a good news as well in Italy, believe it or not, we also are in the vaccination campaign in Italy. Is yesterday news that we finally managed to open a vaccination center in Italy. It will be staffed by our medical doctor and nurses, returnees from Africa, totally volunteer for free. The 12th of June, people can start to book the vaccination in this new facility in Padua. So thank you very much for your attention, and thank you for putting up together this impressive number of people and the seminar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Astori. That was extremely interesting. I've taken some notes of some words that you mentioned that I'm seeing they are being repeated by all the speakers, which are partnership and network, community engagement and education, and also support to vulnerable groups. So thank you very much for sharing. And you also perfectly introduced our next speakers, which is Dr. Flavia Bustreo, which is chair of the Governance and Nomination Committee at the Partnership for Maternal, Newborn and Child Health. Dr. Bustreo will discuss the super debated topic of COVID vaccine and the biggest vaccine campaign in the human history, following the one for the eradication of polio probably and for smallpox. And she will discuss the challenges of achieving universal health coverage with a vaccine. She will also cast light on the COVAX platform that was previously mentioned by Dr. Astori and also by Dr. Zoe So. And she will discuss with us some of the main points of the Global Health Summit and of the Declaration of Rome. So thank you very much, Dr. Bustreo, for being with us, and I give you the floor.
Thank you very much, Clelia and colleagues. Thanks so much for inviting me to be part of this meeting organized by the University of Parma, and for sharing some reflection on the challenge that which is ahead of us in achieving universal coverage with a vaccine against COVID-19. As the previous speakers have highlighted, the COVID-19 pandemic has been an unprecedented tragedy, has already caused more than 3.5 million deaths in the world, has interested all regions and all countries of the world, and the cases are counting, growing, and at different moments of time, like currently, we have a very severe and unprecedented surge of the pandemic in the Indian subcontinent. One thing that has been not so mentioned so far is that in this context, there has been a totally unprecedented scientific advancement, which also deserves celebration, because as many of the colleagues here know, and the audience will know, since last year, the first sharing of the genetic code of COVID-19 by the Chinese scientist, to the injection, the shot in the arms in the UK and in the US, less than a year has passed. And I have to say that this, in my many, many years of leading the World Health Organization, all work on immunization, vaccine, and biological, and being associated with the Gavi board, including chairing the Gavi board, co-chairing it for several years, we have not seen anything like this. This is totally unprecedented. It's the results of scientific collaboration and ingenuity of people and putting together the push to the mill, which deserves celebration. However, as the previous speaker's presentation have highlighted, the world now is faced with an equally unprecedented challenge, which is to mount a world immunization campaign that has maybe only as precedent, as you have alluded to, Clelia, in the smallpox eradication, which was achieved as a main success by the World Health Organization in the 70s, and with the polio eradication, which is still not achieved. We are still struggling in the last two countries, Pakistan and Afghanistan. So when you have such a campaign, there is a need for an incredible and unprecedented collaboration that encompasses all elements of vaccination. That is the vaccine manufacturing and production, the supply of the vaccine, the distribution and the trade aspects of the vaccines, the trade barriers and the export barriers that many countries can place, the planning, and of course, all the aspects that I'm sure in the second part of this seminar, we will highlight more, which is really having the vaccination sites, having the community workers, having the vaccinators being able to deliver the vaccine. And it also requires a structured and organized campaign to overcome vaccine hesitancy, because this phenomenon has become, unfortunately, very prevalent, particularly in industrialized countries, but is becoming more important also in low-income countries. So as we have seen the struggle to advance the coverage of immunization with the different vaccines that have become available in the last few months, what we have also seen is another phenomenon that is worrisome, which is the so-called vaccine nationalism, which means that the countries that have hosted the largest pharmaceutical companies that are producing the first vaccine approved for use, they have also utilized the majority of those doses being produced for their own population. And we have seen the emergency of a huge disparity in the coverage, in vaccine coverage between the rich and the poor countries. So just two numbers to highlight these incredible inequities that we're seeing. We are currently, data from the World Health Organization shows that 1.6 billion doses have been administered globally but only 1% of those doses has been administered in Africa. And 83% of all doses have been provided to high and upper income countries in the world, and only 0.2% to low income countries like Myanmar, which we have discussed at the beginning of this seminar. So how to deal with these incredible inequities is a huge challenge of the day. And what I would like to share with the group is basically three modalities that are currently being highlighted, which require our collective push and require also the actors that are in this conference and seminar to raise their voice and to really demand out of governments. Number one, there is a collective platform, a global platform that is called COVAX. This is a platform that is formed between Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness and Innovation, and the World Health Organization. And it deals with all aspects of vaccine from the research phases to the production and especially the distribution in the market. Now, this groundbreaking collaboration has made a lot of progress, as we have heard also on the slides from the professor from Myanmar and also from Andrea have highlighted that the vaccines that were reached low-income countries especially, they were coming from the supply of the COVAX vaccine. However, this both the financing of this platform and the provision of the vaccines to this platform has been lacking. And so the interesting part of what you alluded to, Clelia, which has been quite unprecedented, the Global Health Summit convened by the G20 with the leadership of Italy last week in Rome, convened by our Prime Minister, Mario Draghi, and the President of the European Commission, von der Leyen. This Global Health Summit has really called for the countries of the G20 to have an urgent effort to support this COVAX platform by sharing the excess doses that high-income countries already have, and to support all the efforts to increase the production of the vaccine. This has been also matched by some good news at the Rome summit of announcement of donation by the large pharmaceutical complex that are at the forefront of producing the vaccine. So we have heard, for example, Pfizer BioNTech announcing 1 billion doses of their vaccine, which is one is among the first vaccine and one with the highest efficacy, to be available before the end of the year through the COVAX platform. And similarly, Johnson & Johnson also has announced 200 million doses. And the European Union has also made significant announcement of 100 million doses throughout the sharing of their member states, including France, Germany, and Italy itself. But there is another aspect that is really pressing for the debate and where I really hope that the colleagues here can help elicit the pressure on the states, which is the aspects and the theme of the patent and the trade impediments for achieving much significant increase in the vaccine production. So this is another initiative that is currently being undertaken under the umbrella of the World Trade Organization. It's an initiative that has been proposed by the government of South Africa and the government of India, and incidentally also supported by Gino Strada, you mentioned at the beginning of the seminar, Clelia. And this initiative is calling for a temporary suspension of the patent that are linked to the vaccines, the first vaccines that were developed. And also is calling for the sharing of the knowledge and the know-how for the production of these vaccines. Because there is no way that the world can just depend on three or four pharmaceutical companies to produce the billions of doses that are required for all the population in the north and in the south. So for the moment, there hasn't been an agreement on this proposal. And unfortunately, the rules of the World Trade Organization requires a consensus agreement on this. As something completely unprecedented has happened, that the United States government has supported this proposal. And I have to say, I'm very proud that also the Italian government, through the voice of our Prime Minister last week at the Global Health Summit in Rome, also supported this proposal. The European Union is still not, is still divided in this proposal, but I know they are discussing as of today whether they can coalesce and find maybe a third way where there is a temporary limited suspension, but there is also some voluntary sharing of the license from the pharmaceutical large complex that are the ones that are producing most vaccine. So in conclusion, Clelia and colleagues, I like to really ask that the colleagues and the students and the university and the actors that are participating, that they continue to apply pressure on the governments for this sharing of vaccines so that we can address what otherwise risks to be a greatest inequities in health in our century. And also reminding all of us that it's not just the right things to do. It's really something that is important for all countries, because none of us is safe until all of us is safe. And if we don't manage through the use and the sharing of the vaccine to control this pandemic in the different parts of the world, we will see a constant emerging of new variants, maybe more aggressive, maybe more difficult to combat, and this will have repercussions not only for the health of all different people, but also for our economies and for our well-being in the world. So none of us is safe until everyone is safe. Thank you so much, Clelia and colleagues.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Bustreo, both for your explanation and also for the call that you shared with all of us. I think your speech opened to many comments, and for this reason, I give the floor immediately to Prof. Sarli, as I know he would like to share some comments and questions. Prof. Sarli.
Yes, first of all, I think that it is useful after the important focus that we needed to listen carefully to all of these interesting interventions. Now we need a little break, a break for our minds, just some minutes, because unfortunately we are running out of time because we've got to listen to many speakers yet. But in these minutes, I would like to invite the speakers and the audience to make questions and comments through the chat. And what I would like to add and to say at this point of this webinar is that, as Clelia pointed out before, not everything is done in this very moment with a view to health as a common good. There are many difficulties. They have been pointed out by Minister Zoe So, they have been pointed out by Alcindo Ferla, but at the same time, there are some solutions that are put on the table. And so this means that the people that are dealing with this issue are trying to cope with. Alcindo Ferla was talking about network. Dr. Bustreo was talking about COVAX as a global platform. So two proposals that meet each other in their deepest meaning. So we are already talking in the whole world of this platform. And ministers always talk us about a plan that is promoted by the national government, his own government, and that is also considered these topics. Andrea's story also showed us what we can do in Africa, for instance, the project that are already underway, even if there is still a lot to do. And so we have to insist on this pathway so that all of these things are translated into reality. So are there any interventions or comments? So at the moment, I don't think there are any questions. I'm not reading anything in the chat. So Clelia, I give you the floor. And you can go ahead with the agenda. But anyway, I repeat it, if you wish to send some comments or make questions, even during the keynote speeches, you can do it by using the chat. So Claria, I give you the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Prof. Sarli. I hope there will be questions and comments. And I invite all the participants to share with us their comments, their reflection. I now invite Professor Glenn Laverack. Professor Laverack is teaching at the University of Trento as visiting professor, and he will share with us the importance of working with communities to prevent and control COVID-19. In particular, it will stress how governments must rethink the response to COVID-19 also in order to be able to answer to future outbreaks and pandemics. As it will stress, learning to live with COVID-19 must remain a priority with a focus on rebuilding trust and engaging with the communities. Professor Laverack, you have the floor.
All right, great. Good. So thank you to Professor Sarli for inviting me and to the organizers for making it happen. Thank you also to the earlier speakers, very interesting presentations. I just want to start off this short presentation just by thinking about whether or not this pandemic has been better managed in some countries than others. From my opinion, it's far too early to say. I mean, we're not even halfway through this pandemia. But, you know, we've already seen that some countries, such as in Southeast Asia and in the Pacific, maybe in Scandinavia, have had lower levels of cases and fatalities. A very interesting study was recently published by the Asia Development Bank on what happened and how it worked better in South Korea. But we can already see that there has been...
Apologies, sorry if I interrupt. I kindly ask you to speak a little bit louder as the interpreter is not clearly listening.
Okay.
Thank you.
Does that sound better?
Yes, definitely.
Oh, there we go. Great. So, as I was saying, the Asia Development Bank recently published a very good study looking at why South Korea had been successful up to that point. But we know in South Korea, there's been a resurgence of COVID recently. The study concluded that it was actually a compliant population, a well-organized government, and the experience of a previous outbreak of MERS, which led to a better response in Korea. Now, whether or not that's going to be the case in the long run, we don't know. Countries like Australia and New Zealand have basically locked themselves down. And with low herd immunity, natural immunity, with low vaccine rollout, once some countries do open up, then they may face a real problem. In other countries, in the Americas, in Europe, in South Asia, we can see large numbers, you know, and it's not surprising given population dynamics, population density, and weak systems that this has been the case with this type of a virus. In Africa, I don't know. Will we ever know the truth of what happens in Africa, what's happened? I doubt it very much. The most comprehensive review of what's worked and what's not worked so far was by this independent panel for pandemic preparedness and response. And it's an interesting study because It's just recently come out, just ahead of the World Health Assembly, which is this week at the World Health Organization in Geneva. So this is not by coincidence, of course. But it shows that those countries globally which have had a better response to and a better preparedness were ones that took a whole of government, a whole of society approach, that engaged with communities and engaged with community health workers and leaders to address the pandemic, rather than just using a traditional epidemiological biomedical approach, which some countries have done and tended to deny and delay and distrust what was happening. Now, a vaccine on its own will not end the pandemic. That's not my words, that's the word of the Director General of the World Health Organization. No one is safe, of course, as we've heard from the other speakers, until everyone has been vaccinated. But, you know, vaccinating the world is really a political aspiration for equity and equality. And in reality, from a public health perspective, it's not feasible. And we can see that from the polio. I've been involved with the polio outbreak in Pakistan and Afghanistan. And it's not just about geographical location and population density or weak systems. It's about areas of conflict, areas that you cannot even access. You know, so we are going to have problems in vaccinating everyone in the world, you know, to control this virus. But there is no plan B. From what I can see, no country has come forward with a plan on how it's going to vaccinate those people that can't be reached or who do not want to be vaccinated. So we don't have actually a plan B at the moment. I think what's clear is that those governments that lead us out of the pandemic are going to use both a top-down, a traditional approach of surveillance and vaccination and testing, for example, and a bottom-up approach where we're working with and engaging with communities. It's going to be those governments that use both that I think are going to be most successful. Many countries have used a traditional top-down disease prevention and control model, which we've been using for, you know, well over 100 years. Society has changed. The way in which societies function and interact has changed. We now have to accept that we have to work with society and not just treat them as recipients. Now, I don't have much time, so I'm just going to focus on three key points, which I think are important to the discussion for the group. The first one is about using or gaining the necessary information about how the disease is being spread. I'm talking this pandemic has been obsessed with the evidence of using an evidence-based approach. But of course, very often the evidence doesn't exist because this is new, or the evidence is weak, or the evidence is contradictory. So what do we do where there isn't any real scientific evidence? Well, we have to use our public health common sense, and we have to use our experience, and we have to look at what's happened in the past. And to me, this is one thing that has been missing. We've too much tried to focus on evidence where the evidence has not existed. And this may well have cost lives in the long run. Important to this is, and this came out of the ADB report and also the other major report looking at what has worked, is getting feedback from people, from frontline workers, from doctors, from nurses, from community workers, getting their experiences. That is good evidence, feeding that back into what is happening on a programmatic level. And also at a community-based level, getting feedback from the community about what is working. Of course, this means using both qualitative and quantitative information. And this raises, from my own experiences of being involved with the Ebola outbreak and the Zika outbreak, how we synthesize this qualitative and quantitative information and translate that into response recommendations and actions. This is a real missing area of expertise in pandemic response and preparedness. We're not able to do this at the moment very well. I just want to give you a quick example of my own experience here in Spain, where I'm working and living at the moment. In working with communities for COVID during the confinement, we used an approach called Footer Voice, which is actually a process developed in Brazil by Paulo Freire. It's now used basically where people in communities take pictures on their mobile phones of the conditions, the issues, the problems in their community. And this information is used by communities and by local authorities to better plan for how to prevent and support people, how to allow people to get better access to local services to prevent COVID, for example. I did publish a paper on this actually in Italian on the DOORS website, which you might be aware of. But I've also written a short paper in English and Italian based on my presentation today, and I've given it to the organizers, which I hope they will share with you so you can see. This PhotoVoz is an established approach, and it really helped these very poor communities, multicultural communities in Spain, to identify issues such as problems with people's fear about discarded masks in the street, and about people that were isolated in their apartments, that were lonely, and that could not access basic facilities such as getting to the pharmacy, for example, to get their drugs. This is what I mean about working with community. Now, another missing thing that's been happening so far in the pandemic in many countries is that this bridge between government services and communities, which is community-based organizations, has this network of community-based organizations has not been well developed during the outbreak. Non-government, voluntary, faith-based, for example, it's very good for building trust. There's an established network, creating a bridge for delivery of services, for communication, and for local action. And this is something that we need to look at as we go on. Because here in Spain, for example, we can see indicators. We can see what is called the colas de hambre. The queues of people queuing up for free food have become incredibly long. Prostitution on the street has become is much, much higher than it was. People are losing their jobs. Unemployment is much higher. Businesses are closing. This is all as a result of the consequences of government action responding to the pandemia. Look, community-based organizations are the bridge between government and community, and they're going to provide the support, not just the services support, but the support to people that have lost their jobs, that have no money, that are going hungry, that have nowhere to live. So we have to look not just in terms of during the pandemic for COVID, but also the consequences, the long-term and possibly more serious consequences of this pandemic. Now, tailoring interventions is an approach that has been used a lot, particularly with disease outbreaks. And I think it's a very important tool that we could use because we can target specific groups and individuals such as the unemployed or the homeless or migrants or just people to help them to comply with using face masks or getting vaccinated. And we can use standard approaches such as health literacy and peer education, for example. An example of this is something called neighborhood mothers, where it targeted migrant women through peer educators, where they met in small groups or online in small groups to identify the problems of accessing local health and social services, for example, and what they needed to do in order to prevent COVID. So working with community-based organizations and using targeted approaches is very important for reaching the vulnerable or the marginalized in society during the pandemia, as well as using mainstream approaches for the general population. Well, don't worry, all of what I've said is, as I said, is in a short paper in English and in Italian, and also in the book that I published just a year or so ago, which was good timing because it was just before the COVID outbreak. I didn't realize it was going to happen, but because of my experiences with Ebola and SARS and MERS and Zika and other things, it was obvious that we were about to be hit by a disease X. And in a way, COVID has been a disease X, but in a way, COVID is not as serious serious disease. There are other diseases out there, believe me, on a list of diseases which is put out by WHO, which has mortality rates well up into the 30s and 40%. And if we have one of these in the future, so we are going to be in very serious trouble. So I see this, in a way, I see COVID as a means for us to try and get our system sorted, to go and get better prepared for the future potential disease outbreak, pandemic. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Laverack. Very important. There are many red threads between all the intervention today. So thank you. Thank you for sharing. Following this red thread, I invite Professor Pedro Melo. Professor Pedro Melo is from the Catholic University of Porto, and especially from the School of Nursing. Professor Melo has an extensive experience in nursing and community nursing, and he has also developed a model of evaluation and intervention, which is based on the vision that the community is the objective of nursing care. So Prof. Melo will discuss with us the pivotal importance of nurses in the global response to communities and also on their role in facing the pandemic. So Professor Melo, I invite you to take the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Unfortunately, I'm going to speak English in my presentation because I cannot speak Italian fluently, but I would like to thank you all, and I do it in Italian. You're a fantastic group of people, so I would warmly thank Clelia and Professor Sarli and the rector of the University of Parma and all the organizers for organizing this historical meeting. And now I switch to English.
Okay. And share my screen. Okay. So now, starting my presentation, I'm going to focus on the nursing approach related to community health, as you asked me to approach. So I will divide this about 10 minutes into three parts. I will start by clarifying some concepts related to nursing and community health. Then I will focus on the relationship between COVID-19 and community infirmities. And finally, I will conclude with speaking in nursing as a global response to community health. So to understand the contribution of nursing and nurses to the global response to communities, it is necessary to define some concepts. First, that nursing, derived from the Latin word infirmus, means taking care of those who are not firm, contrary to what many think, associating nursing only to care for sick people. After that, these infirmities, in the light of the conceptual framework of nursing science, are related to three processes of people. The intentional ones related to knowledge and skills, values, beliefs, adherence, behaviors. The unintentional ones related, for example, to physiological processes. And the process of interaction with the environment related to the human elements, physical elements, economical elements, or political elements that involve people. So with regard to community nursing care, according to the theory that I developed in the context of the PhD, community health nursing care is the development of a collaborative and empowering action for the community, underpinning the approach of community management as an enhancer of community health gains sensitive to nursing care in this case. It integrates the approach of community empowerment as a process in the integrated and integrative vision of the community as a whole, and as a result in empowering the community to reach the maximum level of community empowerment. This means that nurses, especially community health nurses, make a collective infirmity approach. So considering the International Classification for Nursing Practice, ICNP, that nurses use, for example, in Portugal to document all their care in the information technologies and the community assessment intervention and empowerment model, MAIEC, the theory that I developed in my PhD. In this context, the central focus of nurses is community management, with community leadership, community participation, and the community process as diagnostic dimensions. Each one of these focus and diagnostic dimensions finds in MAIEC, the model, diagnostic criteria and also interventions prescribed according to the diagnostic findings. Thus, it is possible to understand that nurses take care of infirm people individually in groups such as families and communities, and populations as groups of communities, of course, including families and individuals. Considering the three types of processes that I've mentioned before in the conception of nursing science, then with the regard to COVID-19, it's not difficult to identify, and I'm here sharing with you the experience of nurses here in Portugal, considering the international classification of nursing practice, the focus of attention of nurses that associate to COVID-19. So from intentional process, we have the knowledge of persons about COVID-19 and protection measures, the skills to use PPEs, the beliefs about susceptibility to infection, and the adhesion behaviors to protective measures and COVID-19 tests. In the unintentional process, we have the infection symptoms management in community, and nurses have a particular proximity with persons to help them to manage these symptoms, but also the immunization process in which nurses are having an important paper, an important role in vaccinating people. And the process related to environment, for example, related with family dynamics related to lockdown, such as marital satisfaction, where we are having an increase of violence in marital way, and also the parental role, the parents taking care of diseased children, or the caregiver role. Also the residential building, the family incomes that are having a special, have been affected by unemployment or inability to work due to lockdowns, or even community issues related to participation resources in a community-based approach to find answers to different COVID-19 issues regarding, for example, community partnerships or community coping. Nurses also can contribute to the development of epidemiological surveillance of all these nursing diagnoses in a public health approach. And we are working in all of these diagnoses with nurses here in Portugal. So concluding, we can see that if nursing care is care for the person without firmness, when we speak of the collective of people and community in infirmity, we speak of a political social system without firmness. And the system, of course, is people. And community empowerment is then integrated into decision-making of nurses, a noble way of giving firmness to the political social system, promoting the health of populations and citizenship. So no health policies to take advantage of the specialized care of nurses, and we will have a world with firmer future too, not only regard to the COVID-19, but in all dimensions of people's lives. So this was my introducing. I hope we can have a dialogue after this. So thank you and grazie tutti.
It was extremely interesting, and I found very important the fact that there are so many connections between all the intervention that you're sharing with us today. It really reminds us what we're discussing about, and the fact that we are facing a global pandemic that we're trying to look for a global answer. So thank you very much. I now invite Professor Anne-Marie Müller from the University of Freiburg in Germany. Thank you very much for being with us. Professor Müller will discuss the psychosomatic relapses related to COVID-19 and their management. In particular, she will provide us a brief insight into the various aspects of mental health and the COVID-19 pandemic. This will range from psychological consequences for the general population, especially for vulnerable groups, and for COVID-19 infected patients. Professor Müller, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Clelia, for the introduction, and thank you very much for inviting me to this panel. I will quickly share. Can you see it?
Yes, perfect. I can see.
So, of course, listening to all the previous speakers and to the perspectives and the efforts and the fight against the COVID infection and the dynamics of the infection, sometimes it can seem a little bit of a luxury problem to look at mental health issues connected to these kind of pandemics. But I'm from psychosomatic medicine and psychotherapy, and we believe in a holistic biopsychosocial model and belief in systems. And so I will keep it with the quote from the WHO that there is no health without mental health. So we'll have a brief look at what does this experience of such kind of a pandemic, a global pandemic, and what kind of consequences can that have on our minds, on our community from a mental health perspective. So is the COVID-19 crisis also maybe a crisis of the soul? So when we think about COVID-19 and the psyche, what is the first things that come to mind? And I think for many people that comes to mind what is very burdensome is this, some of the measures, for example, the social isolation, not to be able to meet family, to meet friends. Also Professor Sali, in the very beginning of his introduction, he expressed that this is a very new experience for some people or for some communities to have this loss of control and this feeling of powerlessness that we are suddenly in a different world that we hadn't known before, that it's so much out of our control. We cannot control the virus, we cannot control the state measures, what they do, we cannot control our fellow human beings. So we have a little bit of a feeling of powerlessness, and the longer all of this takes, the more of the tiredness and the fatigue also happens with everyone. I think we can all kind of identify with this kind of tiredness. We also think about specific vulnerable groups, which is children and family, for one, because the more we have a lockdown, the more stress and burden is in the families. Children cannot go to school, parents cannot go to work, so home office homeschooling has to take place at the same time. Also, Professor Melo just mentioned it as well, that there is an increase in violence in families, which we cannot see. We don't have so much insight because of lockdown, because children are not in school, because we are not interacting as sufficiently with people anymore. We also think of the elderly and the sick people who are in nursing homes, who have been isolated from their families, who are especially at risk to die from a COVID-19 infection. We also think about other people in need of care who usually would have access to helping to facilities that could support them, but now are more isolated and more lonely and don't get enough care. We think about healthcare professionals who have always been in the forefront and had to shoulder a lot of the burden, especially nurses. And I think I just read in the news an estimation from the WHO that over 115,000 healthcare professionals have died from COVID-19 infections so far. But we also think about people who cannot, because isolation can also be a privilege that I am able to have a home office, but there are many people who have to go out, face the risk because they have to provide for their families and earn the money, and they have to be exposed to other people and carry the risk and the burden of the knowledge that they might go home and infect all their families. The same mental stress burden, which was also there for the healthcare professionals. We think about the social and economic situation of the people, job loss or insolvency, which is a huge burden and fear for the future. We think of people who already have psychological disorders, because they are in general, even before the pandemic, they were on the rise. We have a lot of people with depression, anxiety, addiction. This is a traumatic experience for many people. There is also still now, which has to be researched, the direct consequence of a COVID-19 infection. Is there some neuropsychiatric damage because of the infection or because of the treatment afterwards? It's a very important topic now. We also think about how is all of this related, no? And we know that social isolation and job loss is very highly associated to depression, anxiety, addiction, and even suicide. We have some old challenges like stigmatization for mental health issues, but also new challenges that are all over our life now, like this very interesting webinar. Now all of it is digital, so we have to navigate a digital world. And we have now also the long COVID question. So what will be the long-term consequences of an infection? And I think there are many more challenges that we're even not aware of yet. So all of this I can summarize as stress. It's a lot of stress, and stress will lead to a lowering of the cognitive flexibility, which can lead to a narrowing of perception. So that basically means we're more aware of all the negative things and the daunting things happening around us. And we lose the focus of what is still good, what is working, what can help us. This additional stress surely is also a factor of demasking psychological disorders. Many people have some symptoms, subsyndromal symptoms of a depression, of an anxiety, but it was manageable. But now with this additional stress, it was, so to speak, the last straw. And now, it manifests in a clinical pathological disorder. Also interesting topic, but I will not go into it now because it's too much for this short speech is, of course, our immune system, the connection between stress and or being very stable and being able to oppose stress, and this effects on our immune system and warding off infections. So what is the situation? Very, very quickly, I will just show two meta-analyses that have been published by the end of last year with data from the first wave of the COVID-19 crisis. They encompass many countries. The first one is 17 countries with over 162,000 people, the other one six countries with 1,700 people. And it shows that there is a rise of symptoms of anxiety, depressiveness, and stress, general stress and post-traumatic stress. And to put it into perspective, put it now into German perspective, anxiety has a population prevalence of about 15%, usually depression 9%, and post-traumatic stress 2%. So it is quite a big rise in these symptoms, although we have to be careful when I say these prevalences for Germany of 15% anxiety. This means like the clinical diagnosis after a clinical interview. And these studies have been phone surveys, usually with some question of, have you had these kind of symptoms in the last 1 or 2 weeks? So it's not a diagnosis, but it shows that there's a lot of these kind of symptoms that people experience. And who are especially at risk? We see from a household pulse survey from the US that especially young people are at risk of having these kind of symptoms. Over 50% of the 18 to 29 year old young people say they have had symptoms of anxiety or depression. And to put that into perspective of the household pulse survey from the year before, from 2019, then it was only about 10%. So it is very much for young people on the rise. And also another systematic review shows that the ones at risk are young adults, students, women, and people who have a very high level of exposure to COVID-19 media communication, where it's also a question of what type of media communication, right? It's how much do they consume this information. And I already said there's now studies about the direct effect of a COVID-19 infection to the to mental health. So we have some health records and retrospective cohort studies, and we can see that there is a reciprocal relationship between the COVID-19 risk and neuropsychiatric disorders, meaning that with a previous neuropsychiatric disorder, the likelihood of infecting with COVID-19 was much higher. And also the other way around, if you had a COVID-19 infection afterwards, you have a higher risk of developing or having a neuropsychiatric disorder or diagnosis, which is also again shown in this health record analysis, where we see that 33.6% of people who have, or patients who have infected with COVID-19 in the 6 months following this infection, they develop a neurological or psychiatric diagnosis, with the highest of these diagnoses being anxiety disorder of 70.4%. And it's now important also to see why. Is it because of the inflammation of brain tissue, or is it also because of the experience of being helpless and fearing for your life, or is it like a combined effect? So this is all very daunting, of course, and I wouldn't be a proper psychologist if I wouldn't also put a little bit of insight and stress into what can we do and what are the bright side, if there is one. And of course, on a community and an individual level, there's a lot we can do and a lot that helps us to keep strong. Emotional stability and the sense of self-regulation of I can control myself, I can do something, is very important, as well as an internal locus of control. So if I have the feeling I can influence things and I can shape things, and I'm not just at the mercy of all of this, at the mercy of what the state is doing, of the health system, or of my community, but I can do some things. I have an active coping strategy. This can be a very good protective factor against mental health issues, and that includes activities like sports, healthy sleeping patterns, looking for social support, also in new ways via Zoom or whichever. And also having a good, asking for better leadership at workplaces, for example. We have this PERMA model from Seligman, from positive psychology, that also says you need, it's important to promote these points, like promote positive emotions in daily life, promote engagement in your community, and also having then afterwards, when you engage and do things that are meaningful to you, and you foster the relationships in your community, you can get this feeling of accomplishment, of I've done something and I've achieved something, and this is a really very strong protector. This is a very short, just some tips for the workplace, which we all, I think all of us now are home office workers, at least part of the time. So having very clear structures for yourself and planning for yourself and taking care of yourself, of breaks, this is all very important. And in general, that when we say we live in a VUCA world, meaning a world with high volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, there are certain antidotes, vaccines, mental vaccines that we can also apply in order to combat the threat and the fear and the lack of resonance and the lack of connectedness. So what can we learn from psychotherapy? It's we cannot beat the virus. That's not possible. We cannot put everyone in a happy state or fix the world. But what we may be able to do is to help people to develop steadfastness and philosophical patience, enduring the suffering. And this is a quote, of course, from Jung. Thank you very much for your attention. And I'm at the end, and I hope I didn't take too long.
It was extremely, extremely interesting. And again, he stressed the importance of seeing all the aspects related to health, not just the physical one, but especially the mental one, which is something that I believe this pandemic has taught us very well. I now invite Dr. Maria Augusta Nicoli to take the floor. Dr. Nicoli will share with us the technology of contact tracing as technology in use during COVID-19. And she will explain us how we can implement in practice this technology. And she will share with us theory, processes, and examples. Dr. Nicoli, apologies. We need to ask to you and to the next guest speakers to respect the times as we are a little late. Thank you very much, and I give you the floor.
I apologize, but I will speak Italian because I am more fluent in my mother tongue, of course, and I hope more brief also. I would like to stress one point. Since February, I'm a member of the Rede Unida Internacional, and I will talk about it in detail in a short time. The issue io sono su inglese, non mi sentite? Pronto? Io sono su inglese con l'audio attivato. Non mi sentite? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Ah, ecco, su inglese. No. Can you hear me now? I was saying that the topic I'm dealing with today is a new topic, because this type of analysis will be presented for the first time. So there will be some gaps, of course, but I would like to challenge the destiny. So let's start this presentation. Please, Clelia, tell me my speaking time when I have to conclude. First of all, the choice of talking about contact tracing. Talking of the contact tracing with regard to the pandemic means a little bit entering from the back door. Maybe you can remember the book of Thomas Mann, Death in Venice, where he suggested that you have to enter in Venice from the back door, from the San Marco Church. In this case, we enter from the back door because this kind of overlook, this kind of perspective can allow us to go into the detail of the technical human structures that have been put in place for the COVID-19 management. These structures have a specific operational logic. They seem to be neutral, but indeed they are not, because they convey an approach which can be questioned. First of all, they hide some processes that Chiara Volpato and colleagues define as dehumanization. You subtract humanity to the others, from the others. So dehumanization is a phenomenon subtracting humanity. one of the forms through which this process occurs is the biologization process. Other people are considered viruses, and being considered as viruses, some strategies are adopted, that is killing, sanitization, and you have people in charge of such killing. And this is to recall those phenomena going around the forms of dehumanization through biologization. And this is something that concerns all of us, because we'll not produce killing operations, of course, but if we think of the icons, typical icons that are conveyed through mass media, the image that we can see concerns some forms going through purification and identification of people that are considered as infectors and of the virus. So being threatened by a disease such as COVID-19 is an important source of biologization in an in-group versus out-group approach. And at the very beginning of this pandemic last year, Chinese were biologized because they were identified as the virus to it, and from them we needed to stay away. Then also Italians have been biologized when Italy became an important disease outbreak point. So Italian people had become infectors and had been dehumanized. That action was mediated by proximity, emotional proximity to the very dramatic situation we were living. So in daily life, this turned into, for instance, in our services, in our healthcare structures, we talk of people that are of dirtiness. If you enter an hospital today, the terms that are used, the common terms currently used to identify the paths for people that are positive to the COVID, the positive people are conveyed to the so-called dirty path. Then there are other linguistic approaches, strict contact, for instance, close contact, a contact through which you risk of being infected by this virus. But indeed, in your dialogue and sharing of views with the users through the phone calls or through contact tracing, it is quite difficult for people to understand what close contact means. So they translate it into a form of deep friend. So this semantic approach stresses a distance between the people being part of a system, having specific attitudes, sometimes also dangerous attitudes, then you have other translations and our narratives through tables to data concerning the infection. All this leads to emphasize a vision of the person as a virus, not to talk about what was at the very beginning of the identification of the strategies to contain the virus spread, the social distancing topic. A lot has been debated about the use of the word social, because social indeed maybe was not the better word to use to express this idea of distance, of physical distance. And also the videos that have been produced in the different units of hospital, and mainly in the Emilia-Romagna region, evidence how, with regard to this level of dehumanization, what was needed was humanization indeed. Some examples have been collected in the hardest phase of the lockdown that evidence that a COVID unit of a hospital, in some cases, patients were asking doctors and practitioners to sing songs because a specific song could allow the specific patient to relax and be able to better accept the treatment. And I'm referring to a specific hospital unit where then nurses and practitioners have worked a lot to try to find some specific songs that could better fit the taste, the musical tastes of patients. So on the one side, dehumanization, but for those living within these systems, the need to introduce some humanization level. And this picture of Massenissen taken in São Paulo in Brazil, was been a world award, a hug between the mother and the son through a plastic cover, allowing them to hug and break that physical distance. We have been talking of contact tracing to be considered as a technology that, of course, if we consider it in a general way, can be considered so. I've run out of time. So contact tracing seen in its use. So the summary is that through some elements that have been gathered now quite empirically in different contexts where we now are experiencing this research, this on-field research, we can say that the use of this technology, of contact tracing technology, is stems from the a logic of control, a control approach that through its implementation and forms is emphasized. The so-called the 3T strategies, test, tracing, and treatment, in the official documents is identified with an action of public health, which is essential to fight disease outbreaks. It is not part of healthcare, but it is to fight viruses. So a control approach where reactions to this kind of approach can be easily understood. Over the phone, people answering the phone tell us that they are asked to take a test, people oppose to this request because they say that you close families in their homes. I feel powerless in this lockdown situation. So I skip this description and I conclude my intervention saying that in this approach, we have to think about this type of tool, the contact tracing that is implemented so that it is not considered in a neutral way, in an aseptic way, but taking it into consideration the fact that it can explain a lot of how we are acting, but also on how the approaches, implicit approaches we are putting in place that maybe need to be changed and revised. This could be a first step through an alliance to counteract what is going against democratic life. And to give us a working horizon able to strengthen the territory, the involvement and communities and of the social domain. This is our work as Rede Unida, and I invite all of you to support us in this path. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Nicoli, for what you shared. It was extremely, extremely important and interesting and made us reflect a lot. I'm sorry for rushing, as we are a bit late, and we will keep all the comments and questions for the question and answer session at the end of the speaking. I now invite to the floor Dr. Sauro Forni, which is nursing coordinator of the Italy program of the Italian NGO Emergency that we already mentioned several times today. Dr. Forni will provide us an overview of the emergency vision for accessible, high quality and free healthcare. It will also detail the involvement of the emergency NGO in managing COVID in Italy. Dr. Forni, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good evening to everyone. Thank you for inviting me, for giving me this opportunity. Emergency is an NGO founded in 1994 to give help to civil victims of wars. The first intervention is in Rwanda after the genocide in that country that led more than 8 million victims. And we reopened the surgical hospital there. Then emergency developed, a lot of projects have been put in place. They organize and train the staff in hospitals. We have healthcare, but mainly social projects. We try to hire the staff from the disadvantaged communities, from the victims of conflicts. We changed a little bit from the very beginning. We give immediate help to the victims of wars and conflicts, which is our first aim, but we are present in many countries because the consequences of a conflict come later on. Poverty and social poverty and degradation of these countries. So we have decided in other sectors. Starting from 2006, we work in Italy because we try to work on the pillars of the Constitution, of Italian Constitution, Article 32, and I quote, health is a fundamental right of individual and an interest for the community. So we start working in Italy, in Palermo, trying to give and to respond to those people who don't, who are not able to find a health response over the years. This Italian program is now present in 8 Italian regions, and so many other projects have been started and have been completed in Italy. The main objective of emergency is to give basic health care to people to whom this care is not accessible, and to find a place within the regional healthcare system for all people. We try, we define ourselves a bridge between the individual and the healthcare system, and we work through multidiscipline teams made up of professionals, nurses, psychologists, experts of logistics, and another essential person, that is the cultural mediator, that allow to overcome the first barrier, that is the language barrier. These facilitators are social workers, because they are aware of the rules concerning healthcare and help us in finding a place to these people. This is a summary of what we do in Italy. Last February 2020, we have been obliged, compelled to deal with this COVID-19 emergency. Since the very beginning, we had to find to give an answer. The main goal was to fit our medical centers to be safe for the staff and for the patients. We have put in place a triage protocol and process to assess people at the entrance. And then we have 2 main pillars: formation, training, and information. Training for the staff of emergency. We have young people working with us, because they have a lot of enthusiasm, but maybe they are not perfectly trained to deal with a pandemic event for which we are not really prepared. And starting from our strong experience during the Ebola pandemic outbreak in Sierra Leone, we have realized that we were able to manage the information to manage the COVID outbreak. So we have trained the staff working in our medical centers. Then we have informed people, because a correct information, correct communication is essential in such a situation. And the people catering us are people who don't have any other access to other sources of information, because they do not live in perfect houses. They are often homeless. So we needed to give the correct information, and we did it using what was available to us, the social networks, some videos prepared by our facilitators, distributed on the social channels, translated in every language. We have created some WhatsApp groups. And parallelly, our medical division also worked to train people able to take care of medical literature, because during the last year, medical literature has been enriched by a lot of works that had to be analyzed. So we put some dedicated people to read what was published about COVID-19 to find out the information that could be useful. We have created specific COVID teams made of practitioners, nurses, experts of logistics. A lot of the problems derived from pandemic are logistic problems. The fact that a hospital building get dirty is because we are not able, we are not used to manage flows of people entering hospitals. We are not been able to keep hospitals sanitized from the virus. And these experts of logistics have traveled around in Italy because a lot of regional, municipal administrations have called us to receive some supports. Nursing homes needed to manage the entrance flows to their facilities. Since the very beginning, our staff has been prepared and trained to give the right information. For emergency, it was essential not to stop our activity. This was the main objective that we had, because in 2020, at the beginning of the pandemic, every communication was based on the fact that nobody should go to the family practitioner, to hospital. So what we needed was to counterbalance a world that had stopped its activity. For emergency, it was essential to remain open and available for people, and being a reference point for those people who couldn't get any answer at that time. And I would like to conclude my intervention because I think that I've run out of time. Let me tell you one more thing. I really appreciate the quote at the beginning of our founder, Gino Strada, and I agree that this game can be won only if we work together. The waiving of patents is essential to us, but it is extremely important. Another thing that people need to be informed, because a lot of people, we carry down a fight to get vaccines to people who didn't want to do it. So a lot of these people don't want to be vaccinated. So it is important to eliminate the limits to the supply of vaccines, but we have to make people aware that the vaccination is extremely important. I would like to quote once more Gino Strada. Don't forget that the rights are such if they are the same for everyone. Otherwise, they are privileges. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Forni, also for your final quote, which is like a great summary of all what you said and also of the purposes of our webinar today. So thank you very much for being with us. I give the floor to Dr. Sandro Marra of the University of Parma. He will discuss with us the importance of developing a network of community health, and he will present us the case of developing this network following an ethno-anthropological approach. Dr. Marra, I give you the floor, and I please beg you, I'm so sorry to have this unpleasant role, to stick to the 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Clelia. Our department was established in 2013 we already existed, but we have founded this specific department. At the very beginning, we wanted to build this network to increase the awareness of the nursing school students concerning the relations of communities of different cultures present in Parma. This stems from a previous network of contacts that we had. And the communities of foreign people proved to be extremely interested, have been involved and included in this initiative. We were trying to give an answer to some issues stemming from the third mission of universities, that is implying cultural diversities of the territory in an interaction between institutions, territory, civil society, and associations. And through our migrant background, that Italy lived in the past, we thought a lot about the possibility of overcoming the misunderstanding on the problems stemming from cultural diversities. This system worked so that the representatives of institutions could come to the university classes, and we went to visit the communities. We organized a lot of meetings in the association's facility. We met also, for instance, in the Sikh temple of the Parma community, the Islamic center of Parma, or the Pentecost Mission Center of Nigeria. We organized meetings in these premises, in these facilities, and we shared our views. And our students and the communities were able to remove those biases about other people. Our network has enlarged. And within this framework, we have decided to create a new event involving the communities, an event that we defined the cultural coffee of our university. It was organized in a facility that was not an institutional one, outside the university building, so as to make communities closer to us. And we organized it at the hospital, at the coffee bar of the hospital building. So everyone passing by, stopped there, and were involved in this meeting. As teachers, and the fact of being nurses also, together with an education background very specific, started creating some expectations from communities, a lot of questions of with regard to the healthcare system. We supported them in solving the red tape procedures to obtain a visit at the hospital. Also in complex activities. Then we had had some doubts and we asked ourselves, is this becoming an institutional relation or is it a personal relation? At a certain point, we asked ourselves this question quite seriously, trying to find a dialogue with some institutions that had an experience in this field, to share views with Dr. Forlani, which has been the director of civil services in the Department of Civil Freedom of Foreign Cultures from the Ministry of Interiors. His background was very different from our background. So it was very interesting to share our views with him. He suggested to go on in this path because what we were building, this network of relations, even if it may seem a personal relation, can be useful because we have built some trust, but also because you have an institutional base on which to build more institutional relations. In his opinion, this could be something useful also for the future. He thought that it was very important to get into other communities from an institutional point of view, because you can increase the trust of these communities to the institutions. In a country like Italy, where we talk a lot of integration despite our background based on immigration, we should be experts on this, but indeed we are not. What happens at a certain point after having organized so many events, presentation of the Sikh community, the Parma city, the establishment of the nursing course at the university and other events for the inclusion of a specific association, the Muslim community of Parma, which involved a lot of institutions also from a regional level. All this led to a specific result. What happened? The arrival of this pandemic. We have been aware of this pandemic. And we realized that something was missing within these communities. We found out that the communication of information between the communities and the hospitals was really missing because these communities were outside the system, so they had some difficulties in understanding information and how to behave. So we gave them some suggestions, some tips to manage corpses, for instance, infected with COVID-19, or what to do, how to behave in the praying places. We invited them to close the activities within their Sikh temples, for instance. So they have been the first one that stopped their praying. I will conclude. What that this prove? The need allowed us to build an institutional cycle, a website, sorry, an institutional website required by these communities with the support of the Parma City Council. And this website is now a point of reference and personal contacts. You have my contacts on this website, my colleagues' contacts. So these communities can rely on us. So we need networks. We need to build relations that can be institutionalized between hospitals and the communities by going inside the communities. Otherwise, we risk losing compliance to, for instance, vaccination in case of COVID-19. So we think that the cultural elements of a suitable training for the staff, skills, knowledge, of the nursing staff with high education also from an anthropological point of view is a great asset, able also to be used to respect other communities' traditions. So the need of a network, the need to build territorial healthcare built on the territory, paying special attention to other communities and to social distress so that no one is left behind. And I conclude my intervention. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Marra, for your speech. And apologies for rushing, but we're very late, as it always happens with this webinar. But we thank you all very much for your patience. So last but not least, I invite to the floor Dr. Martucci, which is working at the Lilt Research Institution of Reggio Emilia. And Dr. Martucci would share with us some methodology in research in community health, and especially on the methodology of the case study as research in public health. Taking any time, I give the floor.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you, Clelia. I will be sharing a little bit of some ideas, a little bit of knowledge about how we can access this community knowledge that we have been talking about in many different interventions, starting from Professor Laverack and so on. So we know that communities develop knowledge, and how can we access this knowledge in our work and as an academical community? I had the chance of working on this topic with the team of Professor Sarli and other teams as a researcher. So I will just give some context on case study research and some examples from our research work. The elephant in the room when we are talking about case research is that if we look at the evidence pyramid, we see that case series and case reports are in the very base of the evidence pyramid. But pay attention to the fact that, yes, it is true that, of course, randomized control trials, systematic reviews take less biased and more trustable evidence. But it is also true that we cannot build a good pyramid without a good base. There are some aspects of knowledge that we cannot address without qualitative methods like the case report itself. So we can see that in some environments, also the environments where we medical doctors are mostly trained, pay attention to this, like laboratories and hospitals, the standardization level needs to be the higher possible. So the higher standardization, the better results we reach. But this is completely different when we are approach public health in general and primary healthcare in particular. I'm talking about primary healthcare because it's the main topic of my research, and also one of the main aspects of our cooperation with Myanmar that is has been making so great efforts on primary health care. And so when we are addressing these topics, we are talking about a complexity paradigm. A good metaphor might be that something complex is different from something complicated, because when we are making an intervention in primary health care, in public health, we are talking about a complex system that we put inside other complex systems like Russian dolls. So while a complicated problem is a problem that can be divided into many different tasks and that can be replicated, even if it is even if it needs much knowledge, like it can be building a rocket, a more suitable metaphor for complex issues like public health and primary health care might be the example of raising a child, that it will always be a challenge and cannot be replicated in the same exact way. So it's always a challenge, even if you are the father of the most beautiful and adorable children in the world, like it's the case of mine, it will always give different results. So some references that I think might be useful for everyone, a Bible for case study research is a case study research and applications from Robert Yin from 2017. And health policy and system research is a valuable document from WHO, from Lucy Gilson, and gives some many examples of how can we do this research to better have an idea of how our systems works, and give this idea to colleagues, saving the complexity of primary healthcare interventions, health promotions, and so on. Just a few words. I'm really running just to meet our needs. From our experiences, I will just cite different things that we can do in case study. We can use a multiple case study design, a single case study design, or an action research design, just to give a few examples that we worked with in the last few years. If we talk about multiple case study design, I like to cite a pseudo attribution to Mark Twain. History doesn't repeat itself, but it often rhymes. So when we, if we are able to look at different complex intervention, single experiences that are relevant, and looking for what they have in common, what make them work better. For example, we studied in this way the what worked in a health promotion center in many different projects that had good results, and we tried to see which were the methodology aspects that guaranteed good results. So a possible metaphor to use in this case is that if a study might be on oranges or on apples, we are asking what is fruit, how can we define fruit in general, so which are the elements that make our different projects work. Another possible approach that we can have in case study design, in case study research, is participative action research, where we can accept, and this is really strange for us coming from a medical background, where we accept that when we are generating knowledge about a system, a social system, at the same time, we can generate this knowledge while we are attempting to change it. So we choose to intervene in an environment, respond to what the environment throws at us, and keep gathering data on what is happening to give a complete narration to other people that will confront similar challenges. And I go towards a conclusion, talking about something that is not often acknowledged, that is the single case study. And especially in these very unusual times, single case studies might be relevant, because single case studies are usually used for very typical or very unusual experience, to describe an experience in a holistic way. For us medical doctors, often we think about only the strange patients that can give us single case study, but even social experiences, interventions might be interesting single case studies. If we think about COVID-19, we are describing something new. for everyone. So for example, in my team, we did this research where we tried to describe how our hospital responded to the first wave of COVID-19, rearranging the training of professionals and giving more palliative care doctors and nurses to the infective disease staff. And this gave much relief to patients, but also to the health professionals. So this is an example of what we decided to do. We decided to describe what happened in these unusual times to give this the essence of this experience also to the rest of the scientific community. And it was published in a few months and in the higher ranking journal of palliative medicine. In COVID-19, we are all describing a new world. So a few words about the methodology. We can say that one of the strong points of case study research is the flexible design. It is based on the triangulation of different sources like field notes, interviews, patient records, and with making an effort to save the complexity of what we are describing, giving an in-depth description of models and experiences. As you might see, I chose the image of Lego bricks, something that we can build and change the construction of, depending on what we find in this moment. Another good example might be a kitchen. Each one of us might find its own recipes when we have a kitchen with just some ingredients. And a way of using case study research is to choose to describe your own recipe to the world while you are developing it and sharing this with the other academical environment. Thank you so much. Claudia, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Martucci. Thank you also for rushing, but being exhaustive and clear. I thank you all very much for listening to us and for staying with us until this moment. I know we are late and that we shared much information. I would invite anyone to ask questions or give us feedbacks or comments. You're very welcome to intervene.
I would like to take the floor, therefore breaking the ice. I would like to say that this webinar, this meeting has been longer than planned, but definitely extremely interesting. And I'm not just saying this because it's usually something that we say, but because I definitely believe this, because we took into consideration the idea of health as a common good from very different perspectives, different but convergent perspectives, because we cannot consider the COVID-19 disease like a very serious disease, because it is not more serious than other diseases, but it is a fact that it has been determining some consequences that are unparalleled and unprecedented. So on the one side, this pandemic has put to the table a whole series of issues that still have to be analyzed in details. And I was pretty much struck by the intervention of Professor Nicoli and also by Professor Forni and Marra concerning the problems related to communication generated by a problem and an issue which is so involving and so important and so impelling, but this found us absolutely not prepared and not being able to proactively involve the community and properly communicate with the community. And this has been pointed out by nearly all of the speakers, and this led to negative consequences. So a request that has been made during the first part of this webinar was that of trying to find solutions so as to guarantee a vaccine to everyone, notwithstanding the middle or low income economies, and we even called to the importance of waiving patents on vaccines, but everyone or nearly every one of you has also called to the proactive involvement of communities and to the importance of underlining this aspect. Every one of you has been pointing out that informing properly the population and preventing distorted ideas and beliefs about vaccines is fundamental, because as a matter of fact, due to these distortions, some parts of the population in some countries do not want to have access to vaccines. So mass media very often are used for the opposite reasons. That is, very often they lead to the generation of fears, so that people are scared, and very often they are used to deviate people from going along the proper path instead of driving people along the proper path towards and through a proper communication. So if there is someone wishing to ask some questions, we could have still 5 minutes of time. So let's see whether in the chat some of you is wanting to ask some questions. At the beginning, Professor Alcindo was asking a question that was, how can we reach the population, and how can we leave room to the communities when we've got governments that indeed are repressing and oppressing these communities and definitely want to erase them from the social tissue? And this is a political topic, and this is another one of the issues and the topics that have been put on the table during this seminar. Of course, the seminar cannot give a response and a reply to all of the questions and to all of the topics, but it has been giving voice to many different voices. I would like to make a comment concerning the waiver of patent after the speech of Professor Butreo. There has been a moment in which I had the impression, due to economic reasons and economic interests, that pharmaceutical companies didn't want to accept this waiver. I've been studying geopolitical issues, and I've been working for an important online international magazine, and I had been writing with this respect an article about the difficulties in Africa for African governments to purchase vaccines. So the COVAX platform had to start, but nobody knew exactly how. And so there was a clear problem and a lot of people and countries were recalcitrating with respect to wavering and lifting the patents on vaccines. And so, just before this waiver was mentioned and underlined by the international community, I had the perception that even the social media and the mass media in general were hindering themselves and that none of these medias indeed wanted to clearly say that it was necessary to remove these patents. I had the feeling that nobody really wanted to expose themselves. clearly. This is a comment and a remark rather than a question, of course. But now the situation probably has slightly changed. That was mainly related to the economic interests onto which the pharma industry was entrenched, of course. Thank you, Professor Marra. And I think that at this moment, since it is quite late and considering the fact that many people have already abandoned the webinar, I think that it would be opportune to close the works of this webinar.
Prof. Sarli, sorry if I interrupt.
Sarli, sorry for interrupting you.
But there is one question by Sarah Forney.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, Mr. Forney. I'm so sorry. I beg your pardon. It is just because I wanted to point out the fact that COVID indeed is uncovering a Pandora concerning pharmacology and vaccines in Africa, not only referring to COVID-19. This is simply the tip of the iceberg. And so I really hope that this will help us to open the view and the perspective onto a much larger and deeper problem concerning the management of this problem, not only in Italy, but also in underdeveloped countries and developing countries. Professor Sarli, you are a surgeon, and in some countries such as Africa, you die rather due to, for instance, appendicectomy or other kind of diseases rather than COVID-19. So I just wanted to underline this. Yes, you're right. So Clelia, do you authorize me to greet all the participants and to conclude the webinar officially? Yes, okay. So the recording of this webinar will be available both in English and in Italian on the website of the University of Parma. And so you'll have the chance, if you wish, to spread it and disseminate it so that everyone can have access to the important pieces of information that we shared today. Thank you, Clelia, for your perfect moderation. I would like to thank the technical service and support. And of course, I would like to thank the simultaneous translators of this webinar that have enabled us to offer you the translation both in Italian and in English. And I really hope to be able to organize another webinar soon. So thank you all for participating and for your attention. Thank you.
We will possibly organize a second meeting in presence, as suggested by the rector at the beginning. Thank you very much.
Goodbye.